Let's sing.
I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. So praying as I onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and I shall stand by faith on heaven's table.
Second verse.
Jesus, precious Jesus, oh,
It's time to continue our worship by seeking the Lord in prayer together. So I'd like to invite those of you who are able to kneel with me as we do just that. Thank you. Our Father in heaven, we bow before you this morning in humility, in recognition of who you are. You, Lord, are the creator of this world, of this universe and all that is in it, the author of time itself. And Father, we worship you and we praise you and we honor you. Father, you alone are holy and righteous. We bring nothing to you, dear Father, except ourselves. And because you have asked us to come, we thank you for Jesus this morning. We thank you for his promises to us and claim them. He promised that where just two or three are gathered together in his name, that he will be here in the midst of us. He promised, Lord, that those who come to him, he will in no way cast out. And so we come to you. Lord, we ask for the presence and power of your Holy Spirit this morning to open to each of us individually an understanding of your word. I pray, Lord, that you will anoint Pastor Jared as he opens your word to us this morning. And by the ministry of your Holy Spirit, bring conviction, Lord, through the ministry of the word, of sin, of righteousness and judgment, filling us with hope, filling us with joy as we look to the day when Jesus comes. Father, I ask for your blessing upon every single person that is bowed before you. Lord, you love each so much and know each one so well that even the very hairs on our head are numbered. There is no circumstance or experience of our lives or thought of our mind that is not completely open to you. And Father, there are some who are sick, some facing enormous challenges in life that no one else may even know. Lord, I pray for each that first and foremost they may hear the voice of Jesus speaking to them, because you love them, because you have a plan for them, because you have a hope and a future for them. And I pray that each person may hear that voice and yield to it and know the joy of it. Father, I pray that you will heal those who are sick, that you will provide strength for the challenges and the circumstances of life. But more than anything else, Lord, I just pray that every single person here may know you as their personal Savior and their God, and that they will seek you with all their heart and with all their mind and with all their soul. And know the joy of living, Lord, by your power, moment by moment in your presence, and seeking always the fulfillment of your will and purpose. Father, there are many who are away today as well, some on holidays, some who are sick. The blessing we have sought for ourselves, we seek also for them. Father, as we go from this place, we ask for grace, that we may share your love in all that we do and all that we are. We pray and ask it, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, I'm on. Okay. Good morning. Oh, a little bit down in number. That's okay. So, today I have two gift boxes. Now I need a volunteer. Thank you. Okay, so fill that one. Would you say it's light or heavy?
Heavy.
Would you say it's got a little bit of valuable something in it?
Maybe.
Maybe, okay. Now, I want you to, do you want to fill this one?
Yeah.
Is it light or heavy?
Light.
Do you think it's valuable?
No.
Okay. Open the boxes. So what do we have in this one?
Rice.
And what do we have in this one?
A verse.
A verse, okay. So we'll get back to the verse in a minute. Do you think rice is valuable?
A little.
A little? In some countries, rice is considered very valuable. Now, there is nothing wrong about an item having value, but sometimes we place too much value in things that we don't have, and then we really, really want to get them. But then when we have them, we find out they're not that much valuable. Stuck? We'll go to the Bible for some examples. Okay, so we're going to play a guessing game for the first one. So this is about a person in the New Testament and with Jesus. Can you? And his name starts with J. Any guesses as to who I'm thinking about?
Joseph.
That's a good guess, but we're going towards the New Testament. So someone in the New Testament who was friends with Jesus and his name starts with J.
John.
Very close, but not quite.
John the Baptist.
Not quite.
Jonathan.
Oh, so close. So he's with Jesus, and his name starts with J.
Job.
That's Old Testament. His name ends with S. So it starts with J, ends with S.
James.
Oh, you're so close.
I was going to say Joshua, but that's in the Old Testament.
So, New Testament. Okay, I'll give you the second letter. J, U. And ends with S. Sorry?
James.
Not quite James.
Judas.
Yeah, Judas. So, towards the end of Jesus' life, remember how Judas made a plan and he met with some people and those people gave him something?
30 pieces of silver.
What did they trade that for?
Where Jesus was.
Yeah. Do you think those 30 pieces of silver were valuable after Jesus was traded over?
No.
No. Okay. So second example. Now we're going back to the Old Testament. So it's about two brothers. One starts with J, one starts with E. Two brothers, Old Testament, J and E.
Jacob and Esau.
Yeah. Okay. So what happened with the story of Jacob and Esau?
Esau tries to kill Jacob, Jacob's mother tells Jacob to trick his dad into getting the birthright, and Jacob's dad gave him the birthright, and then when Esau found out, Esau tried to kill him. That's a short clip of the story.
Thank you for the overview. But we're going to skip way back to the bit where Esau took something from Jacob. Do you remember what it was? You said
it? The birthright.
Yeah. So with the birthright, it would mean that the oldest child had greater inheritance and greater position. But Esau wanted it because he was the younger of the two. So remember, what did Esau trade it for?
A bowl of soup.
A bowl of soup. Do you think a bowl of soup's really, really valuable?
No.
No. I mean, it might have been when Jacob really, really, really was so hungry. But afterwards, was it that valuable?
No,
it wasn't. And we're going to go to the first example, way back in the beginning of the Bible, in Genesis, in a garden. Two people. Who were they?
Adam and Eve.
Adam and Eve, yeah. And there was also an animal involved.
The serpent?
Yeah, the serpent. So what happened then? So with Adam and Eve and the serpent, what happened?
Satan was disguised to a snake, and then God said not to eat from the tree, but then the snake, which Satan was, said that you won't die because God said you'll die if you eat it. Then they die.
Absolutely. So what was traded? So remember what they took from the tree? Yep. Did they just take it? Or what else did they do? They could just take the apple, but they would still have the apple. But what actually did they do?
Ate the apple.
They ate it. So they traded a piece of fruit for knowledge of good and evil. Do you think that fruit was valuable after they knew?
No.
No. So we're going to go back to that verse. So where did we say it was again?
Where was it found?
You've got to open the box to see where it's found.
I don't think it was one.
Okay, so what does that say?
I don't know what that says.
Is that Timothy?
1 Timothy 4 verse 10.
Nice. Does anyone want to volunteer to read it?
Yes.
Okay. So I've got it. Oh, no, I don't. Hold on. Yes, I do. Okay. Who said they want to read it? Yep. Okay, so find verse 10.
That is why we labor and strive, because we have put our hope in living God, who is the Savior of all people, and especially of those who believe.
Awesome. Thank you. So, our hope should be in the living God. So you think that God's way more valuable? Yeah? Sometimes we lose focus and we forget about who's really important in life. But God is. So, to recap those stories that we were going through, what's more valuable, 30 pieces of silver or God?
God.
Is a bowl of soup more valuable than God?
No.
No, God's more valuable. And is the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil more valuable than God?
No.
Who's more valuable?
God.
Awesome. Okay, you guys can go back to your seats. Thank you very much for joining me today.
It's now time to take up our offerings for today. Our offerings for today are for the expenses involved with the conference ADRA appeal and the repayment of our church loan. Let us bow our heads as we pray. Dear Lord, I want to thank you again for this special day that you have given to us. And I thank you for all that you have provided so far. I want to pray over our congregation today, Lord, that we give all as we are able, and that we give out of joy and not out of obligation. I pray that our offerings may go far and wide in the work of the ADRA appeal, and that they may also assist in the repayment of our church loan. Most importantly, I pray that we give according to your will, and that it is used according to your will, Lord. Amen.
Good morning, church. Jump through these slides. Thank you for that beautiful music. I haven't heard that song, that rendition before. I thought it was really beautiful. So thank you for coming all the way to Australia to share your gifts with us. It's another beautiful Sabbath day. It's great to have you all here. I know it's holidays, I know it's a long weekend, we've got a few people away, but it's good to see the church filling up. And I know many people are waiting for the baby update, of course. And so there are 9 weeks to go. Little Bub is almost here. So we're slowly buying all the different things we need. We're about to get a car seat, of course, that's very important. There's a million different car seats to choose from, and so that's our latest endeavor to try and find the perfect car seat. So that's what we're up to. Now, Big Camp. I saw before, lots of you put your hand up, said you were at Big Camp. I saw a lot of you there, and Big Camp was just the absolute best. I love going to Big Camp every single year. My parents took me from when I was a little kid, and now it's cool that as a pastor, in some weird way, I get paid to go to Big Camp. It's just the coolest thing to go to Big Camp every year. Thank you for stopping me tripping over. So Big Camp, and Big Camp is just the best. You got these great speakers that they get from all over the world to come and preach to us, great music, great activities for the kids. The great nut meat pies, I'm sure a lot of us enjoy those beautiful pies and smokies and all the different things that they were selling there. And perhaps one of the best things too is just having that time just to hang out with people. Go to their tent, sit out the front, just chat with them, catch up with people that you haven't seen in a long time. And Big Camp's the best. And often by that final Sabbath, we're just on this spiritual high, this spiritual mountaintop. Big Camp is the best. But I don't know about you, but often the week after, you just come crashing down. You come back, you have to go back to work or to uni or to school or just all the busyness of life. And you just come crashing down. And certainly for myself, maybe for you too, it can be a bit demoralizing, kind of, from this big spiritual mountaintop back to just everyday life. And when we look in the Bible, we see the same thing happening. We're going through the Gospel of Luke, we're in Luke chapter 6, and in many ways, Jesus and his followers, they have just been to Big Camp. All the people, they're following Jesus, they've been hanging out with all, you know, the big shot leaders, religious leaders, the scribes and Pharisees in the synagogues. Jesus has been preaching, he's been performing miracles, he just healed the man with the deformed hand. Everyone is on this spiritual mountaintop, but then everything comes crashing down. The church leaders are plotting against Jesus, they're trying to kill Jesus, and things suddenly aren't going so well. And so this morning, that's what we're going to look at. We're going to look at what does Jesus do next. And so if you have your Bibles, I invite you to turn to Luke chapter 6, verse 12 to 16. We're going to see what Jesus did. We're going to see his example. I'm not sure if you've heard a sermon on these verses before. I certainly haven't, so it's been fun preparing this sermon. It's actually not the sermon I had planned to preach today. I had a different one that I was working on. I got right to the end, and God was saying to me, it's not the right one. And I was praying all week, and it's like, come on, God, I've finished it. I've done all the work. I said, no, it's not the one. And so on Thursday morning, I sat down again and started a brand new sermon. And I know this is the one that God wants me to preach today. I know this is the passage that he wants me to preach. And I know that there is someone here who just for you, this is what you need to hear. It's a sermon for all of us, but yeah, this is a special one that God has asked to be preached. So we'll read through the verses. You can follow along in your Bible, take some notes, compare translations. I've got the verses up on the screen here. So the Bible says, one day soon afterwards, when Jesus had healed the man in his hand, Jesus went up on a mountain to pray, and he prayed to God all night. At daybreak, he called together all of his disciples and chose 12 of them to be apostles. Here are their names: Simon, who he named Peter, Andrew, Peter's brother, James, John, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, son of Alphaeus, Simon, who was called the Zealot, Judas, son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who later betrayed him. These are the 12 apostles. So let's pray, and we'll jump in to our study this morning. Dear God, as we study the Bible, we invite your Holy Spirit to be here with us, to help us understand what we are reading, and to help us draw lessons for our life, to find meaning for our lives. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So Jesus, he just healed the man with a deformed hand, and as we talked about last time, the religious leaders hate this. The religious leaders, they want to destroy Jesus, they want to murder him, they want to murder God. This is their decision, and you can just feel their hatred as you're reading through the scriptures. You can just feel their hatred seeping out of them. They hate Jesus, but Jesus knows their plans. He knows that in less than 2 years he'll be executed, he'll be resurrected, he'll be back in heaven. And so he needs to choose this group, a group of people who will continue the work that he has started. And if we look in verse 12, how does Jesus begin this process? What does he do? Does he go around, you know, hanging up job advertisements all over Palestine? Does he go to the local synagogues and go, who are the best students? They're the ones I want. Does he hold a preaching contest? Does he go, who has got the most baptisms? What does Jesus do? What does he do? The Bible says, one day soon afterwards, he went up on a mountain to pray. And he prayed to God all night. You can see here in this picture, this is the area that Jesus would have been in. It's the mountains around the Sea of Galilee, and they're not massive mountains. It's not the Swiss Alps. It's nothing like that, but they're decent mountains. It would have been a decent hike, hiking up from Galilee up into these mountains, and this is what Jesus did. This is where he was. This is where he was praying to God, and Jesus did this a lot. We read through the Bible, he would go into the mountains to be alone with God. And so I think this is a challenge for us, you know. When's the last time that you were alone with God? Not just for 5 minutes, for 10 minutes, you know, all night like Jesus was. Maybe all day for 10 or 12 hours. This is what Jesus did. He's our example in everything. When's the last time we spent this amount of time with God? Jesus always did this before making a big decision. And so this is the example he sets us. Before you make a big decision in life, bring it to God. Pray your heart out to him. Have that time with God. Verse 12, it tells us that Jesus prayed to God all night. Now that is 6 words in English. You can see it there. But it's only 1 word in Greek. It's this interesting word, dianoukteuo. This interesting word, it's only used once in the entire Bible, and it means to endure through the night. You wouldn't use this word to say it was dark all night or I slept all night. You'd only use this word to describe some kind of effort, some kind of struggle that you've been through that's lasted for the entire night. That's what this word means. And so this word is telling us that Jesus was awake. The whole night, he was awake through the darkness. He was enduring. He was persevering. He was praying his heart out to God, saying, God, show me what to do. This is Jesus' prayer, and this is a challenge for us as well. When we pray, are we persistent like this? Is it just a quick 2-minute prayer? No, I'm done, God, do it. Do we pray with this endurance, with this persistence, with this perseverance? Do we wrestle with God like this and say, I am not letting go, I am not finishing praying until you show me what to do? This is how Jesus prayed, and I think it's an example that is worth following. It's an example for all of us. There's something else that we miss in English where it says that Jesus prayed to God all night. It's saying in Greek, if you directly translate, it says, Jesus was in the prayer of God all night. And this is really interesting because Jesus is human and Jesus is God. And the prayer he prays is literally the prayer of God. We see here the Trinity in action. Jesus is speaking with God the Father. He is speaking with God the Holy Spirit. This is Jesus in his humanity. He is praying all night for clarity on what to do. And this is Jesus in his divinity. He is praying the very prayer of God. What this means is that Jesus' prayer is perfectly consistent with the will of God, because he is God. This is the mystery of the incarnation, the mystery of the God-man Jesus Christ. This is what we see here in these verses. I don't know if you've seen this before, but when I was researching for this sermon, I thought this was so powerful. I'd never seen it. This is the Trinity in action right here. Jesus in the very prayer of God. So that's verse 12. And we're going now to verse 13, which says, "At daybreak, Jesus called together all of his disciples and chose 12 of them to be apostles." The first question is, what is a disciple? And the answer is, it is a learner, a follower, a student. That is what a disciple is. In ancient times, in both the Greek culture and Jewish culture, you would have prominent rabbis and philosophers and teachers, and they would attract followers. It's not a foreign idea to us. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, we all have followers. You know, it's something that we all understand. But back then, it was really hard to be a follower. You couldn't just click a button. You actually had to physically walk and follow this person wherever they went. You had to physically follow them around. And all the famous rabbis and philosophers and teachers, they all had followers. Jesus had a massive number of followers, of disciples, of students, because there was no one else like him. There was no one else like Jesus. There was no one else who could teach like he did, who could do miracles like he did, who could heal diseases, cast out demons, control nature, feed the crowds. There was no one like Jesus. No one else had this supernatural power. No one else had this supernatural truth. Only Jesus. And so he drew people to him like no one else in history. Now, if we read through the Bibles, it never gives us an exact number of Jesus' followers, of his disciples. It was certainly more than 12. If we read in John chapter 6, it says, Jesus fed 5,000 men, plus 5,000 women, plus all their kids. You add it up, and scholars say there could have easily been 30,000 people that were following Jesus. And so that is a massive number of disciples that Jesus had. They're following him around wherever he would go, and 30,000, that's a massive number when you consider that the population of ancient Jerusalem was only 80,000 people. In almost 1 year of ministry, Jesus had pretty much half of Jerusalem following him. I don't know if you heard that before. I researched and researched it to find those numbers. Jesus had 30-odd thousand, the population of Jerusalem, 80,000. Jesus had pretty much half. And so you can see why the religious leaders, they were getting scared. So many people were not following them anymore. They were following Jesus. They were losing their power. They were losing their popularity to Jesus. The Jewish historian Josephus, he also tells us that of the 80,000 people who lived in Jerusalem, there were also 6,000 Pharisees. Also the Sadducees, the scribes, all the other ones, but just the Pharisees, there were 6,000. So you start to get a picture, you start to get an idea of what is happening here, why they wanted to get rid of Jesus so much, why they wanted to kill him, to murder him. They were scared. They were scared of losing their jobs, their popularity, their power. And people do crazy things when they think they're going to lose their job. Now, as some of you know, I helped make a Sabbath School app, and you might have seen it on the screen here. It's free. It's got the Sabbath School lessons in 51 languages. You can read it anywhere, anytime, in all these different languages, 51 languages. And I like to think that everyone would like something like this, a Sabbath School app. You can use it on your phone, your iPad, all these things. But every now and then, we get interference, shall I say. We have legal discussions, is one way to put it, with certain institutions around the world who don't like this app. They don't like the idea that you can read the Sabbath School lessons for free. They say that if people start using this free app, then they won't buy the printed booklet. And if they don't buy the printed booklet, well, then how will they employ the person who prints the booklet? I can understand that. You know, I'd also say it's available on the website for free anyway. We're just putting it into an app. But people, they do crazy things when their job is threatened. I'd say, you know, it's 2019. We use apps for everything. But people do crazy things when their job is threatened. And this is what we see here with Jesus and the Pharisees. This is the kind of interaction that's going on. And so we have Jesus, and he's praying all night, and he calls together this massive crowd of followers. He calls together all of his disciples, and the Bible doesn't tell us how every single individual disciple came to follow Jesus. It doesn't tell us those stories, but it does tell us the stories of seven of them that Jesus specifically called. He said, "You follow me." And if we look in John chapter 1, we hear about Andrew, Simon Peter, Philip, Nathanael, who was also called Bartholomew. If we look in Luke chapter 5, we find James and John and Levi, Matthew. And these guys have been Jesus' disciples for a while. They're standing there as part of this group. They've just been following him along with everyone else, along with this big crowd. And then with everyone watching, Jesus calls forward only 12 people. Only 12. And how do you think they're feeling in this moment? I reckon they would be pretty excited, right? It was a Jewish boy's, a Jewish man's dream to be chosen by a rabbi. It was their dream of dreams to be chosen by a rabbi to be one of their followers. And this would have been, I think, just an absolute mountaintop experience for them. This is Jesus. He's doing all these miracles. He is the most powerful person ever. And he calls them to come forward. They would have been so excited, I think. But at the same time, I wonder, you know, if they were just a little bit skeptical of what was going on. You know, here's Jesus. He's been rejected by all his family, by all his friends. The Pharisees are trying to kill him a number of times. They hate everything that Jesus is saying and preaching. He's been thrown out of all the synagogues. And then suddenly, Jesus is like, "Hey, you, come with me, and I'm going to make you my official representative." You just wonder in their minds, can you hear the gears grinding? You're going, what's actually going on here? Why, you know, everyone wants to kill him, and now he's saying, "Hey, you come with me." And I think of the fishermen, you know, he chose a whole bunch of fishermen. They were big and strong men. You know, maybe they're thinking, maybe Jesus just wants some bodyguards, right? Maybe that's what they're thinking, you know. Maybe Jesus just wants someone to blame when things go wrong. I mean, he literally chose a terrorist. He chose Simon the Zealot. The Zealots were terrorists, cloak and dagger type of stuff, stabbing people in the streets. That's what the Zealots did. That's who they were. Everybody knew this. And yet Jesus goes and he chooses a terrorist to be one of his 12. This is absolutely crazy stuff. And you can just kind of think, you know, maybe Jesus needs some self-defense. Maybe he needs some people taken out. What is going on here? Why is Jesus choosing us out of everyone here? You know, we never made it through religious school. We never made it through the synagogues. We don't have all this religious training. Why is he choosing us? Eventually, of course, they wanted to become these great godly leaders, but I just wonder, when I read the Bible, this is kind of how I think, it's a snapshot into Pastor Jared's mind. I try and think, you know, what is going through their heads? How are they thinking? How are they feeling? How are they reacting? They're just human beings. They're just people like you and us. They certainly would have had all these different thoughts. And I think it's cool to read the Bible in this way, just to try and get a snapshot, to look at the pictures, see what it was like, what is going through their minds. And so we have Jesus here. He chooses the 12 official representatives. And verse 13, it calls them here apostles. We often refer to them as the 12 disciples. Here they're called the 12 apostles. And it's a word that comes from the Greek word apostolos. You might have heard that one. And it simply means the sent ones. An apostle is someone who is sent to do something. Now, the language that most people spoke in Israel at this time was Aramaic. Jesus spoke Aramaic. And in Aramaic, the word for apostle is Salia. Back then, a Salia was an official representative of the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin was like the Supreme Court of Israel. That's what it was. And so when there was a legal dispute or a religious dispute, the Sanhedrin would send out these official representatives to sort it out. These representatives would have the full power and the full authority of the Sanhedrin. They would act on their behalf. Famous rabbis, they also had Salia, these official representatives who would go with, who would carry the power and the authority of the rabbi who would teach in the rabbi's name. All the Jewish people knew how this system worked. There was nothing new here. But I think it still would have been amazing to see Jesus in this moment saying, I am just as important as the Sanhedrin. I am just as famous as all of these rabbis. So I'm going to have my own apostles who carry my power and my authority and my teachings. Remember that Jesus had just healed this man with a deformed hand on Sabbath, and the religious leaders are absolutely furious at him. They want to kill him. And now here's Jesus, and he's choosing these apostles. And what he's saying, what he is declaring to all of them, is that I'm no longer just a one-man show. This movement is growing. My kingdom is expanding, and there is nothing you can do to stop it. This is a bold move by Jesus. Go to our last verses. And what do we know about these 12 disciples? I know many of us here have read through the Gospels before. What do we know of these disciples? What do we know about their lives? Certainly one thing we know, totally undisputable, is that Jesus had a pretty hard time teaching them. They were stubborn, they were defective. They certainly weren't great theologians when Jesus chose them. If they were, they would have been picked up by the rabbis. They certainly weren't great theologians. Perhaps their biggest problem, we're going to look at a number now, their biggest problem, I'd say, is that they lacked spiritual understanding. And this is a pretty big deal when you're doing spiritual work, not to have spiritual understanding. Throughout the Gospels, Jesus kept saying to the apostles, he says, you guys, you totally don't get it. You've totally missed the point. He says, do you still not understand? He says to them. He says, are you dull? Can't you see? It's a pretty brutal assessment, I think. It's certainly incredible that the Bible records these words. No one would want this said of them. No one would want this written of them for all eternity, for everyone else to read. But the Bible records these words. And I think it's so important because Jesus never covers their defects. Jesus never pretends that these guys are perfect. And maybe that's why we don't see them as heroes. We read through the Bible, we know the heroes of faith, the heroes of the Old Testament. We think of David and Samson and Joseph and Moses and all these different people. They are the heroes of the faith. And we often don't think of the apostles in this way. But I think Jesus points these things out on purpose. He wants to know, he wants us to know, that he can only work with defective people. Because that's the only type there is. That's who Jesus works with. Defective people. Is there anyone who tries to hide their defects, to hide their mistakes? It's just being ridiculous. It's being dishonest. We're all defective because of sin. But Jesus works with defective people. So what does Jesus do to cure the apostles' lack of spiritual understanding? What does he do? He teaches them and teaches them and teaches them and teaches them. Even after the resurrection, just before he goes to heaven, Jesus stays on for another 40 days and he is teaching and teaching and teaching and teaching them about God. That is what Jesus does. And so that's our next lesson. If you feel like this, if you feel that you lack spiritual understanding, you're in pretty good company. Look at the apostles. It took them ages and ages to figure out this whole Christianity thing, this whole gospel thing. So if this is you, I encourage you, be patient with yourself. Keep on praying. Keep on reading your Bible. Pray for the Holy Spirit to help you. Pray again and again and again. Let Jesus teach you. This is what the Bible is telling us. So the apostles, they lacked spiritual understanding, and they also lacked humility. This is another big one. They were selfish, they were proud. We look in Matthew 20, and here's James and John, and they get their mum to go and talk to Jesus, and she says, can my two boys sit with you in the kingdom? And when the rest of the apostles hear this, they are absolutely furious, you know, not with righteous indignation, but with just pure jealousy. How dare they get this position in the kingdom? How dare they get something better than us? And what does Jesus do? What is his response? What does he do to cure their lack of humility? He sets the example again and again and again and again of what humility, what it looks like. He carries his own cross to his own crucifixion. You can't get more humble than that. If you want to learn to be humble, Jesus, he is your only example. The apostles lacked faith as well. They lacked faith, and this is another brutal one from Jesus. Throughout the Gospels, he says to them, "Oh, you of little faith." He says, at one point, he even turns to them and says, "How is it that you have no faith?" That's pretty brutal. I don't know anyone here in this room would say, yep, I've got no faith. Here's these disciples, apostles, following Jesus, and he turns around and says, you have no faith at all. What is going on with you guys? If you read the last chapter of the Gospel of Mark, it's literally the verse before the Great Commission. And Jesus turns to them, he rebukes them for their stubborn unbelief and their hardness of heart. They still don't get it. They've seen Jesus come back to life. They still don't get it. And so I think if you're one of the 12 apostles, this would be pretty discouraging. Your rabbi, your teacher, Jesus saying this to you. But what did Jesus do to cure their lack of faith? He kept doing miracles. Jesus' miracles, they weren't primarily for the unbelievers. They were also for his apostles to strengthen their faith. And so if this is you this morning, if you feel that you lack faith in your life, think back through everything that's happened to you. Think of your life's journey. Look for the miracles in your life. Jesus still does miracles. He is still in the miracle business. And I know for every single person here, if you look through your life, you will see miracles. I guarantee it. The apostles lacked faith. They also lacked commitment. They followed Jesus while things were good. They followed him while there were miracles, while the crowds loved them. But as soon as the soldiers came to arrest Jesus, they were gone. They were out of there. They scooted off. Mark 14 says, all of them deserted Jesus and ran away. And so what did Jesus do? How did Jesus cure their lack of commitment? He prayed for them. And he prayed for them. Read John 17. Jesus is praying his heart out for them. He's praying that they will become committed, that they will become united. And so if this is you, you feel that perhaps you lack commitment on this Christian spiritual journey, I encourage you to read John 17. Read it again and again and again. This is Jesus' prayer for us. This is Jesus' prayer for every single one of his followers. This is Jesus' commitment to you. And that's what will motivate you to change. That's what will bring you commitment. A final one. The apostles lacked commitment and they lacked power. In Matthew 17, they go and they fail to cast out a demon. And they come back to Jesus and they are shocked at how weak and powerless they really are. And what does Jesus do to cure this? What is his solution? Who did he send at Pentecost? Acts 1:8, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. If you lack this spiritual power in your life, pray for the Holy Spirit. So these are the 12 apostles. And when you look at them, you've got to say to yourself, why on earth did Jesus choose them? Why would he choose people like this? Why would he choose them as his official representatives? Why would he choose people like that who have no understanding, no humility, no faith, no commitment, no power? Why would Jesus choose them? Jesus chose them because, really? They're the perfect candidates. Because there is no human explanation for what they could achieve. There is no human explanation for anything they did. They were weak. They were defective. Defective disciples, defective apostles. But Jesus could see beyond that. The world looked at them and they saw just a bunch of dirty stones, right? But Jesus looks at them and he sees the diamond that is hiding within. That is what Jesus sees. He could see their potential if they would surrender themselves to him. In Acts chapter 4, Jesus has gone back to heaven and the apostles, they come crashing down from that mountaintop experience with Jesus. Been with him for 3 years and now he's gone. They come crashing down. But Peter and John, they start preaching the gospel, and eventually the Sanhedrin, they don't like it. They have them arrested. And I love what it says here in the Bible, verse 13. The religious leaders were amazed when they saw the boldness of Peter and John. For they could see that they were ordinary men with no special training in the scriptures. They also recognized them as men who had been with Jesus. Back at Big Camp, we had great sermons and great music and great concerts and great kids' divisions and great nut meat pies and all these different things. But now that Big Camp is over, and we feel ourselves coming down from this mountaintop experience, what do we do? What have we learnt this morning? I think the answer is that we pray and we pray and we pray and we pray. We keep following Jesus even when it's tough. Even when it's tough, we follow him. And when he calls our name, we step forward. And we go where he sends us. Maybe today you sit here and you think, I don't know if I can do that. I don't have this great spiritual understanding. I'm not as humble as I should be. My faith and commitment aren't as strong as all that. I certainly don't feel powerful. That's good. That is good because that means Jesus can use you. And one day, people will see. They will see your boldness. And you'll be amazed when they say, I thought you were just an ordinary person with no special training in the scriptures, but I can see that you have been with Jesus. This is what the true mountaintop experience looks like. And this is the miracle that we get to live every single day. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for this passage in the Bible. It's such a simple one, it's such a short one, but it teaches us so much. We thank you for your boldness in your ministry. We thank you for setting us the example of prayer. We thank you for choosing these 12 apostles, totally common, average, defective, sinful people. And yet, you could see the diamond inside. You could see something special that you could use. Thank you for calling them. Thank you for the work that they did spreading the gospel. Thank you for their ministry. And thank you that through them, people could see you. And we pray the same for our lives, God, that when people see us, that we may have no special spiritual training, whatever it is, that people see you in our lives. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Singing. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his lamp than to be
Dear God, we thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day. We thank you that we can be here. We thank you for our family and friends who are here with us. And we thank you for Jesus. Thank you that he came to earth, that somehow the God of the universe put on a human body and dwelt among us. Thank you for loving us that much. Thank you that your love and your grace and your mercy is made perfect in our weakness. We pray, God, that as we come down off mountaintops, perhaps now, whenever it is in our life, that we remember that you are always with us, that you always care for us, you always love us, that you have big plans for our lives, despite the fact that we are common, average, defective, sinful people, that you love us, that you died for us, that you are coming soon to take us to heaven, to be with you always. Pray that day is soon. We look forward to seeing you face to face. We ask all of these things in your name. Amen.